Thank you, everyone, for coming out in this cold weather in between Christmas and New Year's. It's really nice to see everyone here. I think I would like to start off tonight by giving you the reason why I picked this topic, why this topic of Be Perfect was something that I really wanted to talk about. Often when we're in groups and we're discussing topics here, we use a lot of very small words, actually, to mean a lot of big ideas that are we're not maybe so clear on. So we talk about God, we talk about love, we talk about forgiveness, and we talk about it as if we all agreed on what these things meant. And it's not really true, right? We have a very imperfect idea of what a lot of these things are. So instead of my usual way, instead of screaming in the dark, I decided to try to light a candle. And so I picked this because somehow when people said, well, one day we're going to all be perfect, it sent the chill up my spine. And I said, what exactly are we talking about when we say that? And so tonight's lecture is the fruits of my reflection. Why I got a chill up my spine whenever I heard that. You know, when I was a schoolboy, every subject I had a textbook. And I thought these textbooks were like the long lost books of the Bible. You know, they had perfect truth and there was nothing missing. And if I just got it all down, I'd know everything there was. And if you know, every textbook has a bias. Every textbook has an agenda. And so I have an agenda. If anyone else were to give a lecture on Be Perfect, they would approach it from a different way. So I want to be, you know, upfront with you about what my agenda is. So I started with the passage from Matthew from which Be Perfect comes. There's 10 verses, Matthew 5, 38 to 48, that culminate in the command that Jesus gives us to be perfect. So that was my inspiration. But I needed guides somehow for those things. And so I have two guides that I used. One is the Spirit's book, and there are people in the audience that I've given questions from the Spirit's book to help us along with this as the lecture proceeds. And the other is the idea that it became more and more clear to me what Jesus was looking at when he said to be perfect was not some future perfection, but a perfection now. And I took that from the command, be perfect. He didn't say become perfect, that something's going to happen in the future. He said to be perfect. And in order for us to be perfect, Jesus would not command us something that we couldn't possibly do. So we have the ability to be perfect. And because, you know, often you get, I get the feeling that people go, you know, there was some kind of mistake made. I'm really not supposed to be here on earth. I'm supposed to be on a better planet somewhere. I'm not really supposed to be in this body. I know it's something's wrong, and they, you know, someone pushed the wrong button somewhere. And here I am. But it's not true. We're here. We're in a human incarnation. And if we really truly believe as reincarnationalists that there's a purpose to having human existence, if we believe that there's a purpose to having human existence, then we have to examine what it means to be a human being and why we're here. So what I'm going to limit myself to is human perfection. So other people might be willing to talk about divine perfection, and I hope, you know, I would like to hear something like that too, but I decided to limit my talk to what I consider human perfection. Because as I said, the command is be perfect. So when we talk about perfection, you know, we can talk about a lot of different things. We talk about the perfect day, the perfect hairdo, the perfect vacation, the perfect husband. Oh, forget that one. Okay. I don't no such thing. But I mean, what are we talking about when we talk about perfection? Really, when you think about perfection in the sense, the spiritual, religious sense that we're talking about here, we're talking about virtues. And we can kind of use those interchangeably. When we talk about being perfect or perfections, we're talking about living a virtuous life. So I will use the word virtue a lot as a synonym for perfection. A good working definition, I think, of virtue is the habitual disposition to do good. And there's two components in here. There's the disposition that we have and the good that we have. And we're going to be taking a look at what this means closer. But, you know, for example, our disposition could be, I'm doing good, I'm following a set of rules. I'm doing good. I'm keeping from getting punished in some way. You know, I'm trying to stay out of the way of the law, or I'm staying at God's law or a man's law. I'm trying to stay on the right side of the law. That could be a disposition as well, right? Or you could say it's some kind of interior disposition that I have, that I have to feel it, or I have to want it, or something like that. So there are a lot of things to disposition. And there's a lot of things to what the good is as well. I mean, what is good? I mean, there's a lot of big philosophical questions in here, which I think we can tackle too. So what does it mean to be virtuous? Is it just like, can I be virtuous if I do something self-serving? If I give money to the poor and I get a tax deduction, is that a virtuous activity? I mean, you know, these are questions that's good to ask ourselves when we do what we think are virtuous activities. You know, if I have a good reason for doing something, does that make it virtuous? If I decide that I want to do good in some way, I want to go help out at a nursing home, you know, so if I do good, is that virtuous? Just by going to the nursing home, am I virtuous? So there's some questions like this. What does it mean to have a virtue? These are other questions, but the philosophers love these questions, right? And philosophy can help us to understand what some of the answers are. There are actually three separate traditions. You know, as I said, philosophers have been asking these questions for almost 3,000 years that we know about in the West. And there are three major categories of answers that philosophers have come up with. Now, of course, you can go take a whole course on each one of these three college courses. But this is like a little bit of philosophy fast. And I'm going to go in reverse historic order, because usually the things that are closest to us are things that are easier to understand. The first is called consequentialism. I'm sorry, philosophers love big words, but we could break it down. Consequentialism, sometimes you hear people say utilitarianism, is the idea that you're doing good to maximize pleasure and minimize pain. And you do this by doing the greatest good for the greatest number of people. That's really what it kind of boils down to. That's why it's fast, right? Because we could talk about this for a long time. So if you were to ask a consequentialist, what's wrong with stealing? Why is stealing bad? A consequentialist would say, stealing is bad because it has undesirable outcomes. It weakens the fabric of society. It causes distrust among people. It violates people's right to property, things like this. So this would be the reason why you don't steal. You don't steal because it would make a lot of people, might make the person who's stealing happy, but a lot of other people would be very unhappy. So it's kind of a statistical system. So you say, well, 80% of the people will benefit from my doing such and such a thing, and some people won't. So if more people benefit from my action than not, then it's a virtuous activity. Of course, what's the downside to consequentialism? We have to look at the downside, because each one of these three theories has a downside. The downside is that when you're talking about a good like this, like doing good for the greatest number of people, you often run into what they call unintended consequences. One example is antibiotics, a great thing for a lot of to cure a lot of diseases. But the overuse of antibiotics has caused strains of antibodies that are resistant to antibiotics. Now you got what they call superbugs. So something that looked like it was good good for a large number of people, but we were short-sighted about our use of antibiotics. Another one that I kind of like is the laws against texting while driving. You know, actually, after the laws went into effect, there were more accidents due to texting than less. And they couldn't figure out why, and then they realized, well, before the law, people were texting and driving like this. After the law, to prevent from getting a ticket, they put the cell phone in their lap, and they're texting looking at their lap instead of... So, you know, something that looks like a good has an unintended negative consequence to it. So there's some kind of possibility of short-sightedness when you say, well, it's the greatest good for the greatest number. Also, from a, maybe you want to say a moralistic point of view, the idea of basing good and bad on whether it maximizes pleasure or minimizes pain is hardly a human life. I mean, single-cell animals like amoebas do this. You know, they put amoebas and they put some kind of solution there that they don't like. So you might not say, well, they're maximizing pleasure, minimizing pain, but they're moving away from a low-quality environment or towards a high-quality environment. It's not that much different from what we do when we talk about maximizing pleasure, minimizing pain. By the way, the person that's most associated with utilitarianism and wrote a book on it is John Stuart Mill, the English philosopher, who actually published the book the same year the Medium's book was published in 1863. Sorry. So that gives you an idea of when that came out. And people were very interested in science and numbers and things like that. About less than 100 years before, Immanuel Kant came up with what we would probably be more familiar with, a more religious-based idea, called the deontological. I'm sorry for the big... I always think philosophers like these big words because they feel like they could fit more ideas in a big word than a little one. But deontology, it comes from the Greek word of duty. And so the idea is that there's a set of rules that we follow that we think are good, and it is our duty to follow those rules. And following the rules and our sense of duty towards the rules will produce a good outcome. So again, our disposition here is, and of course, it's not just doing it against your will. It's not like I'm giving something to the guy on the corner because he's hungry, but I'm griping about it all day long. I mean, you do it because you think it's the right thing to do, and not because you're following some rule and I have to give to charity and I have to do this. It's not that. It's actually your disposition, your habitual disposition, is the turning of your will, which is all what we're talking about. The will, in the sense, the will is what we want and what we love. We want to turn our will towards the good, towards these set of rules. Don't lie, don't steal, be good to your neighbor, you know, the 613 laws of the Old Testament, whatever it might be. So if you were to ask a deontologist, why is it wrong to steal? He would say, stealing is bad because it's wrong to steal. There's a rule, there's a law against stealing, and it's just bad because you're breaking the law. And again, this sounds kind of similar to the religious idea that we're used to. The downside to the deontological view is that, well, take slavery in this country. People in the north and south of this country use the same passages of the Bible to either be against slavery or for slavery. So that you can come up with a rule, you know, they would look at the rule and they'd say, look, at this rule says enslaving people is wrong. It's right there in the Bible. And the other people would say, well, look, but there's all these laws that have to do with slavery and how you should treat your slaves. So that must mean slavery is good. So we could use laws to justify pretty much anything we want. We think of them as objective goods, what stealing is and what stealing is not, what slavery is or what it's not. And we can use these laws to kind of justify pretty much anything that we want. And that's the worry of people who are who are against the deontological view. Now you might think, well, these are just a lot of ideas, but philosophers, one of the things philosophers love to do is come up with thought experiments. And here's a thought experiment for you. Let me see. I'm sitting home one day, and Roy knocks on my door, and he says, "Look, me and TJ just had a really bad fight, and I think he's going to hurt me. Would you mind if I hid in your house?" So I say, "Yeah, go find yourself a hiding place. That's great." And a couple minutes later, my doorbell rings again. It's TJ. He's there holding a bat. He says, "Is Roy here?" What's your answer? How do you answer the question, "Is Roy here?" This is the difference between the consequentialist view and the deontological view. If you were thinking, "I'm going to lie to him," then you're thinking about the outcome. You know, you're thinking, well, if I tell him that Roy's here, it's going to be bad for TJ. It'd be really bad for Roy. It's going to be bad for my family because they have to witness the whole thing. And it's going to be bad for their families, and it's going to go on and on and on. And eventually, a lot of people are going to be really unhappy because I didn't lie. So I have to lie. So I'm going to tell TJ, "No, Roy's not here. I'm going to lie." The deontologist would say, it's not your place to decide what the outcome of your action is. You are bound, duty bound, to follow a rule that says, do not lie. And therefore, I have to tell TJ, yes, Roy is here. These kinds of decisions we have to make every day. Here's another thought experiment. You like the thought experiment? They're really fun, right? Here's another one. I love thought experiments. So, you know, somehow you have a terrorist. You've caught a terrorist, and you know that he knows, maybe I should say she or something, or he or she knows where the bomb has been placed. The bomb is, and where it is, and what time it's going to go off. And you know it's like in Times Square somewhere. It's gonna affect a lot of people. So now you have this person, and you're saying, "Where's the bomb?" And they don't say anything. You call your superior, and your superior says, "Do anything you have to get the information. Do anything you want to the person that you captured to find out where that bomb is, because if it goes off, a lot of people are going to be hurt." What do you do? Would you be willing to torture this person, torture one person to save the lives of many? If you did, you're a consequentialist. You would say, it's wrong to torture. It's wrong to torture another human being. But in this case, I'm going to make the decision to torture the person. Or would you say, it's wrong to torture. If he says that he's not going to say where the bomb is, I still cannot bring myself to torture the person. So these are exaggerated situations. Yes, agreed. But you could see how we make decisions like this all the time. Should I tell the truth? Should I not tell the truth? Should I steal 5 pages from the office, or should I go to Staples and buy my own? There's lots of little bending of the rules that we do. Luckily, none of us are career philosophers, so we don't have to worry about this stuff. We can pick and choose, because there's not really a right and wrong answer. Apart from these two is Aristotle's view. That's real, right? He was the pupil of Plato and the teacher of Alexander the Great. And his tradition stands apart from these two traditions, and it's called the virtue ethics view. And virtue ethics, if you ever heard of the golden mean, that term thrown around, this is where that comes from, the idea of virtue ethics. Virtue ethics says, you can live an excellent life, a virtuous life, through personal excellence and avoiding extremes. So he would take something like courage. Courage is a good virtue to have. If you have too much courage, if you throw yourself into every situation, he would say you're foolhardy. That's too much courage. If you had too little courage, you would be a coward. You'd be everything that came up in your life that required courage, you would say, I'm not going to do that. So somewhere in between cowardice and foolhardiness is this mean, this golden mean, which differs for each one of us, but at the same time, it's not at either extreme. If you would ask a virtue ethics practitioner, what's wrong with stealing? He would say, I don't steal because I'm not the kind of person that steals. Very different from the other two, right? Because the whole focus of virtue ethics is the development of character, the development of an individual character through education and through role models. St. Francis would love this, right? Because his role model was Jesus. He'd say, I'm a virtue ethics practitioner. I'm just going to look at Jesus and do everything he does. My life will be virtuous based on whatever he says. Now, again, virtue ethics, a lot of people really value what, even though this is an older tradition, a lot of people who think about these things value virtue ethics because you're doing good because you want to do. It's not just wanting to do. It's actually you feel good about doing the good. And you develop the kind of character where you say, I'm not going to do that. I've made my decision. I'm not going to do that. And I like me for not doing that. So virtue ethics has an objective component to it, like the other two do as well. But it's not a universal. You know, where you're talking about the deontological view, they're looking at statistics. That's a kind of universal. Did I say deontological? I probably said the wrong thing. With the consequentialist view, they're looking at statistics. So this is kind of a universal, everybody, you know, I'm taking a look at everyone, 80%, 90% of the people are benefiting. That's a good thing. So it has an objective piece to it and a universal piece to it. The deontological view says the same kind of thing. It says, you know, I have a universal law, stealing is bad. And it's an objective law too. It's written down somewhere. With the virtue ethics, there's no universal law because it has to do with role models and education. And therefore, there's an objective piece to it because you're reading books, you're educating yourself in some way, you're looking at a role model, but it's not for everybody. And so some people say, well, you know, this is like the argument people have, well, what about the people, you know, if only the people that read the Bible are going to be saved, what about those people who never heard of the Bible? You know, so there's this kind of thing. So these are the three broad philosophical conditions. What I'm doing is I'm laying groundwork for us to be able to look at the passage from Matthew and understand what Jesus is talking about. So what do we have as human beings that will allow us to be perfect? What characteristics do we have? What natural qualities that we have? And I want to talk about three of them. Again, we can give college courses on each one of these, and that's instinct, reason, and free will. Who has reading number two? Yes, please.
Question 73. Is instinct independent of intelligence? No, not exactly, because it's a type of intelligence. Instinct is unreasoned intelligence by which all beings satisfy their wants.
You can read the second one too.
Question 74. Can a line be drawn between instinct and intelligence, precisely defining where one ends and the other begins? No, because they often blend together. However, the actions belonging to instincts and those belonging to intelligence are easily distinguished.
Thank you. So again, there's a lot of different definitions for instinct. My simplistic definition, because I'm a simple guy, is those things that we have the day we're born. Whatever can happen on the day you're born and whatever capabilities you have, those are instincts. Because instincts are unlearned and unconscious in that way. So there's a lot of other things, a lot of other definitions we can have. We'll just use that as a working definition, though. The thing about instincts, well, why do we care about instincts? Because, you know, people think, when you think about what the good life is, if you would ask someone what the good life is, you would think, the good life is satisfying all of my instincts, right? Lying out on the beach, sipping an umbrella drink, you know, having the person that I love lying next to me, and that's it, and I'm happy. I would be satisfying my desire for rest, my desire for affection, my desire for drink and eat, and so that's the good life, right? The problem with instincts, or not the problem, but the limitation of instincts is that they don't change. An instinct starts with a desire, the satisfaction is, oh, I'm hungry, I eat, I satisfy that desire, and it comes back again. I get hungry, I eat, I get hungry, I eat. So there's this constant desire, satisfaction. You don't eat once when you're 3.5 years old and then never eat again, right? So everything that we have that we're born with is something that repeats, even though, of course, our tastes change, that we like different things when we're 3 years old and 30 years old. But the fact is that the instinct does not change. But we can, through our reason, we can modify our instincts, right? So we can ask, for example, for eating, well, why am I eating? Am I really hungry? Am I eating because I'm anxious? Or am I eating because I feel a lack of love? You know, this is, I understand there's a lot of sugar in breast milk. So people, when they lack love, they turn to sugar because they get this kind of feeling that they're, it generates that love feeling in them somehow that they're feeling. So you can question things like this. You could still eat the sugar, satisfy your desire, but now you're asking questions. What should I eat? Should I be a vegetarian? Should I only eat fair trade food? Should I worry about sustainable practices? I mean, these things, you're still satisfying your desire to eat and drink, but you're asking questions of yourself. And by doing so, our reason allows us to modify our instincts and ask questions of them. Because instincts are not moral of themselves. You can't say, is it right to be hungry? It just doesn't make sense, right? It's just, it's there. It's part of the human condition. But we have, as humans, the one of the reasons why the good life is not just lying on the beach sipping an umbrella drink and having the person you love lying next to you, is because we have two other attributes. We have reason and free will. And these two things together allow us to live a conscious and a free life. So the idea of conscious, let's look briefly at reason. Reason gives us the consciousness that we need to live any kind of moral life, to ask questions of what is right and wrong. We need that. And kind of these things are so basic to us. We think about reason, we think about motivation right away. If you see something on the news, even if it's the most outrageous thing, you know, you see something really horrible and someone gives you a reason why the person did it, you go, well, that's a pretty strange reason, or not, I would never, but at least you have a reason. When you don't have any reason at all, it kind of bugs you, doesn't it? To say someone did something and you don't know why they did it? Because reason is such an important part of the way we are. So reason allows us to live consciously, but as we know, both reason and free will, though they're gifts of being a human, they don't always work perfectly. Our reason doesn't work as perfectly as we would like. So one of the things is they have these defense mechanisms, which were identified as part of the Freudian psychology by Anna Freud. Being defensive or projection or all these kinds of things. So you can have a good reason for doing something, but you can kind of talk, you can rationalize your way. You can say, well, I'm stealing, but it's okay to steal because the company's not giving me enough money. Oh yeah, I'm not paying my taxes, but the government's taking too much taxes anyway. So we have a reason, but it's not working properly. We're justifying or rationalizing the things that we do. We have hundreds of ways of doing this. Of course, we can give a whole course on defense mechanisms. But the fact is that we have to consider the fact that reason is an attribute that we're given, a gift that we're given, but it doesn't always work properly. The other thing about reason is that, you know, when we get together here, why are we getting together here? I mean, there's probably a number of reasons, but one of them is that we're getting exposed to ideas that we might not think of on our own, right? So we get all sorts of information which helps us to reason through, and you go, I never thought of it that way before. But in the end, we just don't want to know things. You know, if I want to be an astronaut, I don't want to just read a bunch of books about being an astronaut. I want to be an astronaut. I want to go up into space or something like that. I want to experience what it is to be an astronaut. If I read 100 books on love and I don't love anyone or no one loves me, what good does this do me? So you can be exposed to ideas, but reason is not the end. We don't want to just know things. We want to experience things. So the consciousness allows us to see the things that we might have missed before, but it doesn't give us, it's not the final goal. Free will, on the other hand, does unite us with what we want, and that's why will is often considered, along with reason, that the two of them are both required. Thing about, you know, we talk about free will as if it always worked perfectly, but it doesn't. You see, we think about free will as choice, and it is. Free will is choice, but we limit our choices. Our free will, our will itself is not limited, but we do. When we place conditions on other people and other situations, for they have to, this person has to be nice to me in order for me to be nice back. The world has to be such and such a way in order for me to be at peace. So we are limiting our choices based on something outside of us. And this is when the will goes astray. We limit ourselves. We limit our free will. In the end, we should be free to love regardless of the situation, regardless of how we're being treated. We know this, right? We hear this time and again in the center. We should be able to treat people lovingly regardless of what they do. But we don't, right? This is very difficult. It's a very difficult thing to do. The other thing about, the other thing about will is we often think about, I make a choice and that's the end of it. But that's not the end of it, you see? When you make a choice, what don't you have control of? You have the control of the choice, whether you're going to do something or not do it. But you have no control over the outcome. Say I get this idea, I want to be healthy. I go to the doc, they say, Doc, look, I have this idea I could be much healthier than I am. Tell me how to be healthy. Doctors, make sure you eat well, get a lot of rest, have good social relations, rest, meditate, exercise. So Doc, if I do all those things, I'm going to live a healthy life? No, if you do it, there's a better chance that you're going to live. If I do it, will I live a healthy life? I can't tell you that. We're doing the same thing here, right? We say, if I followed all these rules, is it really going to bring me what I want? So we have free will, we have the choice, but we have no control over the outcome of our choices. And this is really disappointing, right? A lot of times we say, I tried so hard and it didn't come to fruition. I tried to do this and it didn't happen. So free will is a great thing. Free will is a great gift. But as I said, we limit our will, and through our attachment to the outcome, we refuse to see that our choices, that the outcome of our choices is not really under our control. Okay, so that's those things. I mean, all this will come together, I hope. And just laying some groundwork here. So now that we've talked about the philosophical approaches to virtue, we've talked about what we have as human beings that will allow us to live a virtuous life. Now we have to take a look at what can we base a virtuous life on? What do we have? The first thing that I thought of was feelings. You know, how many times have you said, you know, I want to feel good when I do something. If I go to the nursing home, I want to get a good feeling from being in the nursing home. If I give something to the homeless on the street, I want to have a good feeling about doing that. Or whatever it is, if I'm kind to someone, I have to feel it. All right? So, I mean, a valid thing. We talk about this all the time. We talk about, I don't feel like doing this or I feel like doing that. And this actually drives a lot of our decisions, our moral decisions, whether we feel like it or we don't feel like it. The problem with feelings is that, in a way, I'm going to suggest to you, you can't really ask a moral question of a feeling. If you feel angry, you can't say, is it right or wrong for you to feel angry? You feel angry. It's not a question of morality. So this is the first problem with feelings. There's a lot of other attributes about feelings that really give us food for thought, for saying, is it really a valuable thing to use feelings as a basis for virtue? First of all, they're changeable, right? I mean, I could be very happy one day, I go to work, everything is going my way, I'm smiling at everyone, I bought coffee for my the person who sits next to me, I'm smiling at everyone, I'm saying hello, I'm friendly on the phone, or saying a nice thing in an email or chat. But then I go to bed that night, I get a bad night's sleep, I get out of bed, I stub my toe on the end of the bed, I got caught in traffic, and now, get out of my way. Everyone is my enemy. Don't look at me, don't talk to me. So how could we live a life based on just feelings? It would fall apart. I mean, could you imagine saying, I don't feel like going to work for the next month. I don't feel like being a father anymore. I don't feel like, I'm tired in New York. I think I'm just going to move somewhere. We can't, you know, again, these things, as attractive as the idea of saying I want to live a life where I feel good and that's virtuous, there's a lot of problems with that. The other thing is that feelings focus us inward. And every virtue that is talked about is an outward-focused virtue, right? So there's no virtue that says, I'm a virtuous person because I'm peaceful. You know, my life shouldn't be disturbed by anything and that would be a virtuous life. Or, if everything went my way, that would be a virtuous life. Feelings focus us inward, and when we're focused inward, we're kind of shut off from everything outside. When we feel really bad, it's really hard for us to get out of that feeling, right? I mean, everything just shuts down at that point. The other thing about feelings is that they focus us on the present. If you're feeling bad or happy, you're not worried about how you're going to feel tomorrow. You're worried about how you feel right now. And anything that's virtuous, remember, our working definition is the habitual disposition of doing the good. It's not just occasionally I feel happy so that I'm living a virtuous life. No, it's a habit. So anything that is a habit requires a time to grow. We can't just think about how I feel right now. We have to think about, you know, what am I doing? I lost my idea, I'm sorry. But anyway, there is a time, we will get back to this actually. Everything will come home. But there's a temporal attribute to virtues, because when we make a decision, you know, we might say, look, that chocolate cake looks really good. I think I'll just eat the whole thing. That sounds like not a bad idea, right? I mean, at the time. But you're not thinking about the future, you see? And then, but if you did think about the future, you say, you know, I'm probably not going to feel very good after I eat the entire chocolate cake. Or you could think about something that might initially look like a bad thing that turns out to be a good thing. I was thinking about when my son was born and we had to take him for his shots. I remember it was kind of funny the first time they stuck the needle in him, and he just sat there for a while, and he realized what had happened, and he started crying. It was funny. But, you know, I mean, you wouldn't think sticking a child with a needle would be a very good thing, right? But you're looking, as a parent, you're looking to the future. You're looking about what the good, that this bad thing, right now, if you ask me, do you want to stick a needle in your child, I say no. If you ask the child, they say no, but you do it anyway. So there is always this temporal aspect to a feeling that we have to be conscious of as well. So, look at that. Holy mackerel, I forgot all about my readings. The free will reading was number 3. Could I, I'm sorry, we're going to have to go back a little.
Yeah, I was going to.
Yeah, I'm sorry, you should have interrupted me, Valeria. 'Kay, so that throws a little backlight on what we talked about. Who has the one, who has the reading number 4? Okay.
Question 800.
This is about feelings, by the way.
873. natural or is it the product of acquired ideas? It is so natural that you are immediately appalled by the idea of an injustice. Moral progress definitely inspires this feeling, but does not create it. God has placed in the heart of all human beings, and this is why you often find more stringent notions of justice in simple, primitive nations than others that are more educated.
Okay, thank you. So, and we're going to go, the next thing, so we're talking about what we can base our ideas of virtue on. We talked about feelings. The next one is rules, and that's reading number 5. Who has that? Scott.
Question 614, what is natural law? Natural law is God's law. It alone endures the happiness of human beings. It shows them what they should or should not do, and that they only suffer when they deviate from it. Question 619, has God given all human beings the means of knowing divine or natural laws? While many may know it, they do not understand it. Individuals who seek goodness understand it best. Everyone will understand them one day because a destiny or progress will be fulfilled.
Okay, thank you. So rules are intrinsic to a human being. You get two people together on a desert island, they're going to come up with rules. Every society has rules. The thing to be aware of with rules is that they're mainly prohibitive. It's don't do this. If you do that, this bad thing's going to happen to you. So we have a set of rules that aren't really telling you what you should do, but rather what you shouldn't do. Of course, the Ten Commandments say you should love God and you should honor your parents, and that there are positive rules in the Ten Commandments, and there are positive rules too. But it's much clearer when someone says, well, how do I love God? That's a harder question than to answer, perhaps, than, you know, don't steal. we see it clearer in that way. And we might have general rules that we have about how we should live. We should be loving towards people. We should be kind. We should be generous. But we don't really understand what all this stuff means. But if someone says, don't do this, or this is the consequence, then that rule becomes prohibitive. And in a way, we know a whole lot more about negative things than positive things. I mean, the doctor that I went to ask him about the health, probably the first question he would ask me is, are you sick? And not over here, but I mean, are you sick? And I say, no, but I don't know how to help you. I mean, I study pathologies. I study illnesses. I can help you if you have a problem. How many times have you gone to the doctor and said, maybe it's me, but I go to the doctor, I say, you know, I got this and this and this. He said, I can't find anything. I mean, it still exists, but for him, it's some kind of condition that either is too small or too insignificant or unknown. So they don't really know what health is. A doctor does not know very little about health. They know a lot about sickness, and they know a lot about pathologies. And that's their job. Or a lawyer. I mean, a lawyer knows very little about good citizenship. They know a lot about what happens if you break the law and what the consequences are and what they can do to help you. But they don't know much about what it means to be a good citizen. Is a good citizen just following a set of rules? If I just follow a set of rules, am I a good citizen? You know, this goes back to the philosophical positions that we have. Can I just follow a set of rules and say I'm living a virtuous life? Also, rules have this kind of black and white view to it that is really a little dangerous, because we think about, we want black and white answers, right? We want to say this is right and this is wrong. And sometimes you can say this is right and this is wrong, but there's more times than not that it's really kind of in the middle. It becomes your preference. And so we want black and white answers to very, very complex questions. Even for temporal issues, you know, where should I live? Is it the right thing to do for me to move? Should I get this new job? Should I, whatever it is, you know, should I buy this or not buy this? You know, these little questions, we want black and white answers, and in the end, a lot of us have to admit, well, you know, I have more good than bad or more bad than good, so this helps me to decide, but it's not a black and white issue. So rules tend to make us think about black and white issues. It's part of the way our mind works. Our mind doesn't like ambiguity. It likes black and white, on and off, yes and no. So we're talking about feelings. Hard to base our virtues on feelings. Talk about rules. You know, they're mostly negative. And we really can't live a negative life, if you think about it. I mean, if anyone has ever been on a diet here, you will know you can't live a negative life. You could deprive yourself of something that you want for a short amount of time, and then it's going to fall apart. If you think that your will, that just the strength of your will is going to allow you to do that, you find time and again that this is not really the case. Who has reading number 6? Okay, Roy.
Such an act have unfavorable consequences in their advancement? You should do good for the sake of charity, meaning disinterestedness.
Right. Both of these readings, I think, are very interesting because both of them emphasize this idea of disinterestedness, which goes back to something that I talked about before about free will, that we have the ability of choice, but not the ability to control the outcome. And when we make a choice, it's very hard for us not to be interested in the outcome. But we don't control the outcome, and this causes a lot of problems. So this idea is, can we live a virtuous life by having a goal of living a virtuous life, right? So let's try that one. You know, I want to live a virtuous life. I'm not there yet. Now, the problem, well, I should say about goals can be noble, they could be great, they could be beautiful things, but first of all, they can disappear at any time. I was thinking about, you know, say for example, I decide I want to make good use of my time, so I go and I volunteer some organization or something, you know, and I'm making good use of my time, and then I say, you know, I'm really pretty good at this, and a lot of people coming to me and asking me, you know, how I could do this. Maybe I should write a book about how to volunteer. So I write a book, the book becomes really popular, and I go on tour, and I'm talking about my book and signing things and stuff. But now I don't have time to volunteer anymore. So what happened to the original goal? Was the second goal better than the first goal? You see, because what happens with goals is that, you know, here we are. A goal is always about the future, right? We have to use things in order for us to get from where we are to where we're going. And the idea of disinterestedness, as difficult as it is for us to imagine, the idea of disinterestedness is that if you use things, if you have a goal and you're using things to get there, the things that you're using have no value to you. If I want to be an astronaut, I mean, I got to go to school, I got to do all these things. Do I care about the school? Do I care about anything? No, I care about going up into space. That's my whole goal. Anything I got to do to get there, everything in between, I don't really care about. I just have to do it. I have to go through these steps to get where I go. And once I've gone through the steps, they're gone. You know, I went to school, I got my diploma, school is done. So when we're using things for a goal, those things become instruments and not goals in themselves. And that's why our goals can change sometimes. That's why we can switch from one thing to another, because as we're using all these things, our idea of where we want to go changes. So we always say that a virtuous goal is a goal unto itself. So if I'm charitable, I'm charitable to be charitable. I'm not charitable so that I can write it off on my taxes. I'm not charitable so it looks good for my neighbors. I'm not charitable so that I feel good about what I'm doing. Any of these things is using charity for the sake of something else. I'm using charity to be happy. So goals are very very difficult things to handle. We all have them, but to be to have a disinterested goal is almost an impossibility, because the idea of I have to use things to get to my goal. So we talked about feelings, we talked about rules, and we talked about goals. All good things. Don't get me wrong, I'm not throwing these things out. We have feelings. You know, they're real, right? They just don't happen to be good gauges for morality. We have rules. We need rules. We couldn't live in society without rules. Will it lead us to a virtuous life? Well, probably not. We have goals, and goals are a good thing too, because that's how we move forward. We want something that we don't have now. We want to get to somewhere we don't have. Great things. Is it going to lead us to a virtuous life? Probably not. So now, that was the base that I created. What I'd like to do is what I talked about at the beginning. I'd like to look at what Jesus tells us in this passage from Matthew about what a virtuous life, what a perfect life is. Now, if you look at the chapter, Be Perfect, like many, it starts with, love your enemy and all that, which is good. But I went back a couple of verses before, and I hope I'll make it clear. The couple of verses before are about justice. Justice about rules, right? Justice has to do with rules. Justice could be based in feelings too, right? I mean, a lot of rules, a lot of laws come into effect because people feel violated in some way, or they want to be protected in some way. And so a feeling could generate a law. And also a rule, rules and laws are kind of the same. And a goal, you can have a rule to create a goal. So justice is a really great thing. Jesus gives us four test cases for justice. So I'm going to be a lawyer. I'm not a very good lawyer, but I'm going to try my best. I'm going to be a lawyer. I'm going to defend the four cases that Jesus gives us to describe justice for us, okay? So good day, Lord. I have four clients I'm bringing before you today for you to judge their merit. I hope you will find in favor of each one of my clients, and I will defend them to the best of my ability. Lord, the first client I had has been slapped across the right cheek. Now, as we know in our culture, to slap someone across the right cheek, I would have to use my right hand. I would have to slap them backhanded. This, Lord, as we know, is a grave insult in our culture. But worse still is if he used his left hand, because we know that the right hand we used is our clean hand that we use to bring food to our mouth, and our left hand is our unclean hand that we use to clean ourselves after a call in nature. So using that hand to slap that person is a graver insult still than a backhanded slap. Now, we think this is defamation of character. How could this man walk the street after being slapped in such a manner? What is the verdict?
Matthew chapter 5, verse 39. You have heard that it is what said. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you not to resist an evil person. For whoever slaps you on your right cheek, turn the other to him also.
Well, sorry there. My next client, I'm sure you'll find in favor of him, my Lord. Okay, my next client is a poor man. He owns very little in this world. He owns his tunic and a cloak. Now, Lord, he's being sued for these little items that he owns. How could you possibly sue someone and leave him naked in the street? Now, we know in our culture, nakedness is not looked down upon, but not having clothes is. It's a sign of utter poverty. Lord, we hope you're going to find in our favor that this man should not be sued for the meager things that he owns. What is your verdict, my Lord?
Hmm,
well, not my day. Okay, Lord, my third client. As we know, we're an oppressed people. The Jews are an oppressed people. The Romans are in town, and they're in charge, and they have certain laws that we are compelled to follow. Now, one of these laws is that a Roman soldier can ask any person to carry his pack for a mile. Now, we know these packs are heavier than bags that we bring to Brazil. and here we have these strapping, strong soldiers that can easily carry their own pack. And this man, this poor, weak man, has to be taken away from his work and taken away from his family to go a whole mile across town to help this big, strong soldier. We think that an exception should be made in his case and he should be exempt from this law. What is your verdict?
Whoever compels you to go 1 mile, go with him too.
Okay, I have one last case for you. I have one, and so here's this man. He loaned money to a friend of his 6 years ago. As we know, the law that we live under has forgiveness of debt after 7 years. So if I loan, say after 7 years, the loan that he has given to his friend is dissolved and not doesn't have to be paid. Now this person who already owes this the return of this loan has not paid it in 6 years, has asked for another loan. We think this is unfair. What is your verdict? Well, thank you, my Lord. With some luck, I will still be a lawyer tomorrow. I will come with 4 new cases for you. And it might go my way. But you see, you know, for us, we look at these things and they sound kind of crazy, right? I mean, you know, we're asking, in each one of these cases, we have a grounds for, I mean, I know I'm not a great lawyer, but the lawyer could do a nice job on each one of these cases. Now, the thing is, let's take a little closer look at each one of these cases, right? The first case of the man being slapped. Now, I don't know about you. Has anyone just come up to you and slapped you in the face? Have you ever heard of anyone just walking down the street and someone coming and slapping you across the face? Right-handed, left-handed, backhanded, clean hand, dirty hand? Does it matter? No. Something happened before the man was slapped. Not talked about here, right? We have hundreds of ways to get under people's skin. This is not a value judgment. We have certain ways of talking. We have certain gestures. We have certain ways of being that just come naturally to us that we don't think about at all that can really get under people's skin. So we never know how much, when something happens, when there's an interaction like a slap in the face, we don't know how much it is on your side and how much it is on the other person's side. Because in each interaction that we have, like a slap in the face or a nasty comment, I mean, we don't have to think we're responsible for it, but in some ways we're participating in it. We are part of, it's not just we're sitting there and someone's slapping us across the face. The second one I find a little more of a challenge where the guy is asking for his tunic. I mean, you know, the tunic, if you think about it, In our terms, if I were to sue someone for their tunic, I'd be suing them for their underwear. Now, I mean, you would think, who would sue someone for someone's underwear? They would either do it because they themselves were really poor and they didn't have any underwear at all, or they would do it out of spite. You know, but the fact that, you know, those things, I mean, I've reflected on, maybe you have an idea of how, you know, why this would happen. But the fact of it is that why would this person be sued for anything at all? This goes back to almost the first case. We know someone that's just come up to you and say, I'm going to sue you, Roy. It wouldn't make any sense. What do you have against me? So there's something going on there in the background that Jesus is not telling us about, right? The third case, I mean, this one's a little closer to home for us, because how many times do we say, well, the government, this is the law, this is the rule, but I don't like it, and I don't believe in it, and I'm not going to follow it, right? You know, life for the Jews was not easy under the Roman rule, but at the same time, the Romans were great at law, right? I mean, the Romans loved law, they loved order, they loved military things, they created roads. It was the first time that people could really go on the roads and feel safe with the Romans around. And, you know, well documented that people hit the roads much more so when the Romans took them over. They gave them a sense of law and order. Yes, they oppressed them. They did a lot of things that for you and I, we would say, you know, that would be a real hardship, like carrying the pack a mile for a Roman soldier. But the fact is that just like our government, there's a good piece and a bad piece. And when you start to pick and choose and say, the only pieces of the government that mean something to me are the ones that I like, or that mean something, or that helping me, and everything else can go by the wayside, well, you know, we have to think about that too, right? And the last one about the debt, about the person who's asking for a second loan after they didn't pay the first loan. You know, we're thinking about money here, but also let's think that this is almost a case for forgiveness, right? See, the problem is when someone does a wrong to us, we immediately put up a defense, right? In some kind, I mean, depending on the wrong, it could be a real defense or it could be just a little cautious or whatever. But if we lived a life where every time someone did something wrong to us, we just scratched them off the list, what kind of life would we have? We wouldn't know anybody. There'd be no one that didn't annoy us at some point in our life. There is a good spiritual reason for the conflicts that we have with each other. The conflicts that we have with each other deepens friendships, deepens our romances, deepens our relations with our children, with our relatives, with everyone that we know. Every time, if we just smiled all day long, think about it. If all you did were, and this was your life, would this be a deep life? No. The fact is that we have to rub up against each other. We have to have these conflicts in order to deepen our affection for people, and to allow ourselves to practice forgiveness that Jesus is always talking about.